Wasn't me, I thought it was you.
No, I don't.
No, no, it was me. Wasn't me.
I don't know.
I guess we're gonna start the meeting, we're waiting for one of the numbers.
I gave mine.
I didn't just point on it.
Yeah, I'm only about people's fingernails. You do have a staple for it, don't you?
Yeah.
Okay, because I have a pocket knife, but they made me check it out.
Would you want me to do it? The file?
You can copy it.
For now, whenever it's ready.
It's not. Yeah, if we weren't so weary, we would be so weak and ready.
My sister lost that for about 20 years.
Here, there's something to write on. Owners that you might know about. Well, I saw you last. Hey, thanks. Oh, they think you can keep this one if you want. Yeah. This way I know what I said. You always need your alibi, right?
Yeah.
There's one right here.
Okay, are you ready? You look good. Now I can just start. And I guess we can. Have your ACs and cards. Anybody want to talk? Go ahead.
Any comment from the public?
Gary?
I'm a bachelor. Thank you. I wanted to make my suggestions regarding changes or proposed changes to the wind law. And these are my personal observations, not from our group or anything else. First of all, setbacks. I would strongly urge you to go back and look at the setbacks and increase those to 3,500 feet. We've had people, engineers, tell us that the throw from ice can reach that distance very easily. We want to have, I'm suggesting that not only the 3,500 feet, but it be from property lines, not residences. And that's a biggie. And a property owner that has a chunk of land and you do it from their residence, that will prohibit if the tower is put up at that fire into that property. That would prohibit it. That owner of the non-participating property from developing that land to the tower there. And there could be. So it really needs to be from the property line. Also, an issue with property lines is somewhere in the documents early on, there was some wording about the owner of a lease being allowed to negotiate with a neighbor over distances. And I think the board, you have a strong zoning law. You don't let zoning laws be overruled by individual site agreements. And I would urge you that you look at this closely, that you not allow site agreements between the wind company and the leaseholder to change the distances. That's your decision and the town board's decision. And in some of that wording at one time, there was that wording that really troubled me. Property number two, property value guarantee. I don't want to spend a lot of time on that. I just feel that we need to be aware of getting something in there with some teeth in it. The more people that I talk to from Chateauguay that tell me that they can't sell their property. One guy just recently, 8 years he's been trying to sell his property. Can't move. Cannot move it at any price. It's just nobody will come in because there's towers surrounding his house. A girl called me from Chateauguay expressing the concern that for us. She said that she's not a leaseholder. They're a row with the family had leases. She had a row with the wind company. They proceeded to put four towers around her house. Why? She thinks that she knows why, but that's what happens. So, and again, she was trying to sell her property, she could not sell it. And the third thing that I'd like to have you really look at, one of the more recent runs of your wind laws, is talked about noise level standards. And I'm glad to see that at the time from 7 in the evening till 10 in the morning, or excuse me, 10 in the evening till 7 in the morning, you had a 35 dBA. I strongly urge you to do that for the 24 hours a day. You can't have these towers with the sound effects and the health concerns that the sound causes. So please, I urge you to make that 35 dBA for all times of the day. Please take these recommendations seriously. Our job, yours and mine, is to protect the residents of our town and their health. As you finalize the wind law, please do so without the fear of Article 10. That has never been tested. Never been tested. And who knows what it will, the result will be when it's tested. And the people keep saying, oh, it'll be, you're doing something unreasonable in your wind law. Don't be threatened by that. Because nobody knows what's unreasonable. You think it might be unreasonable. Certainly, if you put a 100-foot limit on the height of the tower, that would be an unreasonable thing. The setback that I'm recommending is not unreasonable. Many, many wind farms have a mile setback, and some more. If you read about the history of Europe, they've gone further than that because of the major concerns. Also, not only don't fear Article 10, test it. That's the way to find out what the rule is. Test it. And I think this would be a good place to start. And don't worry about that. Don't let them threaten you with that. And also, please don't consult with the lawyers from Avangrid on your final draft. They have no business recommending to you what should be in your wind law. I said this morning at the town board meeting. It'd be like me building a bank, and I'm going to send the robbers the plans of the bank so that you can figure out what's best for you, for the robbers. Thank you.
I would like to agree with Gary. The setbacks are not nearly enough. If I had my choice, it would be a mile and a quarter, because that's what's recommended by the medical society. But being that we are where we are and everybody's so afraid, I think it should be at least 3,500 feet. But I also feel that it should be in relation to the tower height. It should not be a set distance. It should be 7 times the tower height. Then if at the last minute they say, oh, that's too burdensome, the latest technology is 600 feet, well, now you've got built-in protection. Now it's going to be 4,200 feet from that structure. Otherwise, the bigger they are, I'm sorry, the louder they are from any research I've heard. So they have their own research, but it's done by peers, and we all know what that means. The other thing is the DBA, it should not exceed 35 at any time, not just at night. You know, it's one thing if we lived in a city and we were used to noise all the time. Where some of us live, it's probably not more than 20 dBA. So 35 is going to be noisy to us. So it's all relative. You can't take one standard worldwide and say, well, that fits everybody, because it doesn't. I also feel that you need, I'm sorry, I didn't have a chance to read everything in detail, but there was one part that for complaint resolution, and I thought that there was an awful long period of time. It was like within 2 weeks, but at least not more than 180 days. That's half a year.
If somebody is not able to sleep for half a year, that's criminal. So I feel like we should look at that again, and that resolutions should be made more promptly, or that particular turbine should be shut down until they can figure out what the problem is. I also feel that decommissioning costs should be, they shouldn't be a letter of credit, they should be in escrow. There's too many places that are, Cohocton, I just heard from a lady in Cohocton that the company that put up towers there then sold it to another company. They're not even they're not even paying their pilot payments. So I doubt if they're ever going to get decommissioning out of them if they can't even get the pilot payments they were promised. Another thing, I've said this before, I'll say it again, I'll say it every time we get together, you need to incorporate this wind law in your comprehensive zoning law. It is the best way to protect the town from any number of industrial facilities. Could be fracking, it could be anything, but this just seems to be our first assault, but we could have other industrialization problems come forward. And I would like to see more definitions, and I would like to see DVC levels be added in that, because from everything I read, the infrasound is really much more harmful to our health than what we can actually hear. And so therefore, I think it's very important to have that incorporated in the law. And also, I beg to differ, I do think that there should be some kind of a property value guarantee, because some of us that are in the wind overlay zone, it's going to be awfully hard for us, if these things go up, to even sell our property for a fraction of what we have in it. And I don't think that's fair. You know, people can say, well, we should be able to do whatever we want on our property. Well, that's true to an extent. But you have in your comprehensive law things so that people can't put a junkyard next to you. People can't have an open dump next to you. There are protections in place. So why aren't we being protected from 500-foot wind turbines? I mean, it doesn't make sense. So, thank you very much.
Kelly, right?
I just reiterate that the DVC needs to be part of your regulations. The air conditioning heating industry has addressed DVC. They take those measurements, they make adjustments to their units so that the low frequency sound is not bothersome to people who are living with these units. They have been doing this since 1980s. So for an industry to take an account DVC and make adjustments is nothing new. It's not overly burdensome. It has been done for years. So I highly suggest that you put that in your law. Anything to do with sound is probably above all of our expertise. So I highly suggest that you get your own expert to consult with. That one that is not hired by the wind company. There are several out there that have consulted with other towns in St. Lawrence and Jefferson County, who would be, I'm sure, more than willing to help us out here. So you do have people who are relatively local who can help us with this infrasound. They helped Hammond's Law. That is a defendable in court. But I'm sure as you read it, it probably doesn't make as much sense to you. It doesn't make all that sense probably to all of us in this room, because it was written to be held up in court and by someone who understood it and could back it up. Another thing that I would like is the 35 dBA for the whole 24 hours. Sleep deprivation is a real thing. We have our school children that are going to be living in and around this. We need to protect them. And sleep deprivation at night, when they are being forced to go from deeper sleep to lower levels of sleep, that is what, you might not remember it, they might, the child or adult might not even remember being woken up, but it, they wake up to it to a degree that disrupts their normal sleep pattern. That's what causes fatigue, that's what causes headaches, you know, and it's going to harm our school children as well as adults. And with that, I highly suggest that you do not have any variances as part of your win-law. Because just because someone whose name is on the deed makes a good neighbor agreement to have them closer, how is that protecting our children? It's up to you as the planning board, recommending the town board, to protect all citizens. And someone who is going to get a few thousand dollars is certainly not always thinking of the long-term effects of our children. So no variances for the document, because you guys are doing a lot of work to put the research into the reasons why you have those setbacks. And someone outside of your group in the town board should not be able to negotiate beyond your hard work with that. And I know that in my letter there's a few other things listed, but I'll let someone else go and you can read those at your leisure.
Okay, guys. Anybody else?
Concerning decibels, there's supposedly a fellow named Dan Driscoll with the DEC that, or he may be retired. Is he retired, Patrick? Or is he still working? He's like 70. That doesn't mean he's retired. Sometimes that can help you understand the sound. And we were told that he recommends decibel levels even lower, 33 dBA.
He's a noise guru that has been challenged, of course, and remained standing in his position.
You're talking about Dan Driscoll?
Yeah. In addition, I've given you some suggestions because there were quite a few of us that worked really hard on the wind law a couple months ago, and we backed off for a while. And so I think that it could definitely be simplified and streamlined, but still have more substance to it. I've tried to give some suggestions about a logical sequence for the wind law. I know that this came from a model wind law that perhaps was written back quite a while ago by NYSERDA, perhaps, we're not sure. But one thing that it could be like a logical sequence. First, Article 1 is an overview. Article 2 could be wind measurement towers, because in the law it says that the town board recognizes that you need to know the wind data first. And then to Article 3 could be for the large wind energy facilities. For us, one of the most confusing things about going through were all the different names for turbines. WEX and WEFs and SWEX and LWEFs. And just like, so if we had a more recognizable thing to designate between somebody's windmill pumping water for their horses and a 500 foot or taller turbine that's linked in with 39 others, that would really be helpful. And the difference between one turbine, which would be a large wind energy conversion system, and 40 of them with the connecting lines, that's, you know, it helps to designate those things. So we're afraid we've given you a long list of definitions, but that's one of the things. We're trying to make it easier for the public to understand. In addition, something about decibel levels, I think I was told, and I'm sorry I'm not clear on this, is that each additional decibel level is a magnitude.
Mm-hmm.
That is correct.
That's correct.
So it's kind of like earthquakes. Six is not as bad as seven, and seven is a lot worse than six, and eight is even worse than that.
Mm-hmm.
So
there's a formula that they
doubles,
I think.
Yeah.
One other thing, and you know, we all hate to be here, but if we could, for both here in Hopkinton, if we could have a regular date of the month when we know that we would be coming and talking to you, it would sure help us. And I know it's tough for you guys. You've got lots of other meetings and things going on. We would all rather be doing something else. But a set schedule might make our life a little less insane than they are right now. I don't know if that's something that you might be able to do with us or not. But if we know we have to be ready for a certain date and a certain time, maybe we'd be able to get things to you on a more, you know, reasonable schedule where you've got time to look it over instead of falling over your table and dropping things on the table.
Timely, right?
Oh, that's very timely.
Anyone else? Go ahead.
I'm Kathy McKay. I sent some information last week from a certified acoustic engineer to share with you. Did you receive that?
Okay, I just thought.
From Stephen Ambrose.
One thing, Fred, I did print out for you, the slideshow, I wasn't able to. No, but I'm just telling him it's in the packet.
Is it in that packet, Lori?
Yeah.
Yeah, they all got their packet.
Was that?
Folder.
You got a packet last night?
Yeah, even all your packets.
That's it.
That's one of them.
Yeah, the other is well, it's 51 pages, but it goes real quick. It's his presentation over in Vermont in December.
Yeah, that's on the LinkedIn one.
Well, discussing with him the link to the presentation, is that what you mean?
Yeah, Lori sent me the link.
Okay.
And
well, okay. Okay.
Outside,
well, it might be helpful. He is a certified acoustic engineer, and I've been in contact with him.
And no, who's it? No.
Stephen Ambrose.
The author.
Pardon?
Not the author?
No. No. If you didn't get it, I can resend it to you. You know that folder I gave you?
Last night? Yeah.
I don't think I copied anything like that, so it would be what was in the box.
Yeah, we all got it. So did you. Way out there in the boonies.
I do see this. I saw that this morning.
Where I live. Where it's real quiet.
Where's that?
Captain Field. Like way out there in the woods where you wouldn't think anybody ever set foot in their life. And I'll find a stake that says Wilhelm on it. You can hear the boogeyman coming. It's that quiet. It's 19. 19 DBA.
I just really believe it in May when George Sparrow said.
There you go.
Anybody else? Yes, sure.
Can we appeal for more time?
Can you appeal for a more time?
You got to talk to the town board.
Yeah, we have to move the more time. That was the town board hasn't given up on it. They're just at this point postponed it. We're pretty comfortable that we have plenty of time to work on this law and our zoning code. And if they do think there's a moratorium, it will probably come in late this summer. You know, they'll probably discuss it, but I think they will, I'm not sure, but that's my experience. I think Hopkins did decide to explore getting, having a moratorium. They're in the process of drawing one up, is that right?
No, it didn't, it couldn't fly.
It was only a 2-1 vote, so it wasn't, you know, the motion wasn't carried.
Okay.
We had to have a 3-0 vote.
Okay, I didn't know.
Perhaps you could help them out by helping them get the time, because they've got even more.
We'll get into that in a meeting, it's in our budget for our agenda today, we're gonna talk.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
My only comment would be that Fred, the town board here is also looking for your lead in that issue. I've heard it several times that it's going to be what the town, what the planning board needs, and they'll take your lead. So please keep that in mind, that they're waiting for you too.
So in saying that, my second letter to you is reasons why you, as a planning board, could use the extra time. We were told at, in addition to what I have in the letter, we were told at the meeting in Hoppington by the wind company representatives that they're ready to put in the preliminary scoping statement. So no, in no less than 90 days can they have a application put in. That means in 90, from the time, if they're ready to put that in now, you know, they say in the next week or so they put that in, that means 90 days from now, they could have an application in. So even though the town boards have been talking that they're, in the last time of, not to this morning's meeting, the last Friday night town board meeting, the town board seemed to say to the public, oh, there's no rush in this. There might be, because they, you know, they said they're ready for that preliminary scoping statement. The next thing would be an application, and that can happen 90 days after that. So there are several reasons in the letter that I wrote you of why a moratorium would be helpful to you, for you. And as Gary said, the town board did say several times there will be looking for guidance from you as far as when or if to reconsider that moratorium. So please share the letter with the board and take that to into consideration.
One thing I forgot to tell you this morning is when they bring out their preliminary scoping statement, we only have 21 days, the way I understand it, to comment on that and see if they're really covering everything that should be covered before they consider a project like this, like the studies they have to do, the resources they have to inventory, all that kind of stuff. 21 days, you know, is not much time. And especially when we're going to all these other meetings. So that also is why perhaps a moratorium would be helpful, is because we got a chunk load of work just to deal with the Article 10 process, not just our wind law and our zoning, you know, our land use and development code. And like I said, if it could help out Hopkinton, because Sue's husband, who used to be a town supervisor, I guess, said he talked about this years ago, that this was something they needed. And I think it's patently obvious now that we can be targeted by anybody for anything. Not us so much as Hopkinton, but the two towns are linked. So what happens there affects us and vice versa. So just, you know, if you want to talk to Sue, she might be interested in that.
Okay,
yeah, I got one. Do you have anything in your existing law right now on setbacks for like schools or like the Mill Yard Estate? You know, because there's
the current law.
I mean, other than say, you know, 2,500 feet or something like that, because that, I would think that would be quite a distraction for kids trying to learn looking out a window, you know, seeing their blades turned around. And also Milliard State, you've got older people with various types of diseases, you know, I would think you'd want bigger, larger setbacks in those areas than normal.
The only comment I can make on that is when we did the wind overlay zone, we kept it away from the school and the Milliard State.
Where does it end?
I have to look.
Yeah, because I don't see it on.
That's something you gotta talk about. Yeah, we can talk about this. Alright, and no more comments, I hope. We're gonna move on. We have an agenda, and everybody signed in, I hope. We get paid by the number of attendees. I get the minutes of the February 24th meeting. Need a motion to accept or reject? Motion, get that?
Yeah.
In a second. In favor? Okay. Now, we have unfinished business, review the local law number one of 2012. We received quite a bit of information and comments from the draft law we put out. We really wanted to meet in 2 weeks ago, but we had a sense of meeting at the last minute. These guys showed up.
Both of us.
Yeah, and they're busy.
Number one, he's on the case.
They planned that meeting that night, they showed up, and it's really hard getting these guys together. So we decided we had a work session. What we did, we took the information that we got on the internet and give it to us, and we pass it out and let it. And that's all. We didn't make any decisions. The guys took it home, they're gonna look it over, and we're gonna work on it tonight. Because we can't make any decisions during a work session. All we can do is talk about it.
Why didn't you excuse the person that wasn't in your group from the meeting?
Well, he came in, and we have to have open, if we have a work session, it has to be open. And he was here.
Maybe sure, let somebody else know that you were still meeting them.
Well, like I said, we took advantage of the situation. We had four of the members here. It was really hard to get together, and we had a lot of stuff to do, and so we were good. Yeah, there was a guy from, not from your group here, but he's a member of the public. He lives in Parishville, Dave Jackson in Parishville, and he listened to us. He did talk to us. He told us about his lease and stuff, but he didn't give us any suggestions about changes. No comments at all on the advice.
Those were the circumstances.
He could have been there too.
Yeah.
If you would have let us know.
We talked to him for
a while.
We thought he was leaving, and then he decided to just go around and might as well sit down. So he sat down.
Did you record that session like you do each session? Did you record it? I see you have a digital recorder. That particular session, did you record that one?
No, we didn't.
Okay.
It was just a work session. We didn't take notes. We didn't do any business.
I know you've been long, and I'm sorry, but one other time you said you were going to go to work session. So we respected that, and we stayed away because we thought it was just your group meeting in Joe's office and whatever. So we stayed away, and now you're saying, well, we could have been there at the work session.
In the open meetings law and the Robert's Rules of Order, we do have to have our public. And we didn't. It was a decision at the last minute because we took advantage of the situation. The guys are here, and it's really hard to get together. These guys are busy.
But let's make it clear, Fred, that I was told that the meeting was canceled. It was a travel ban. If I'd have known that you were going to continue on with your meeting, I would have been there.
It wasn't a meeting, Joe. It was a work session.
I would have been at your work session, and so would have some other people here.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really.
I came back from out of town. Go through that to get back here in time for this. And like you said, all we did is pass some papers around and look at them.
The stuff that we get from you guys right now, all the literature that we're getting, this is what we talked about. So, because I don't, we have to get everybody's opinion on what you did to us, you know, and we got another 200 pages of stuff to look through. So when we take all these, we got to get a look at everything. We'll just talk about it, so.
Okay, fair enough.
You know, I mean, that's all I can tell you.
Go ahead, Kelly.
I'm a little confused of why you're classifying something, a meeting as a work session separate from a meeting, because under open meeting law, there is no classification as a work session. It's just a meeting and it has to be open to the public. There is no such thing as a work session.
Excuse me, during a work session, you cannot, you wouldn't conduct any business.
I understand that's what you're saying, but when you dive into the municipal law, there is no such thing as a work session as classified separately than a meeting. I mean, you, as far as having public comment, that is encouraged, but is not absolute. So certainly if you want to have one and say, hey, we're having an open meeting, or we're having a meeting, we're going to use it as work only, therefore we are not having public comment tonight. But as far as classifying something as a work session, there is no such thing. Mm-hmm. So I'm just a little confused.
We're not lawyers here.
So it's boiled down to if they have a secret meeting without the public.
Forget everything we talked about.
It wasn't a secret meeting.
Well, I mean, and on another note, we actually pushed a gentleman out of a snowbank when we were all in here. We went outside. We helped someone out of a snowbank.
Who was here for court?
Then for 45 minutes, I found out the fire station, so if we want to talk about exactly what we did. We actually left and went out and actually pushed him out.
We pushed two people out.
There's two people out because I won't talk about Sherry getting stuck too. But we did other things besides just, but we did visit. So.
But I will tell you, there was another time that one of our meetings was canceled, and I did come sit in the parking lot in case anyone showed up, which I was coming that night to sit in the parking lot because not all of these people have phones.
And we only live, I live across the bridge basically, so we're not that far away,
But if there's ever an emergency and it has to be canceled, I always come and sit in case someone comes. So if you do see me here, you see my car here, it's just because I'm concerned that somebody might come that didn't get the message.
I caught him down at Luke Martin, turned him around.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
I thought for sure they'd show up. I knew they would.
He did.
That's what we heard.
Yeah.
Because I got the last memo late too, so.
So sorry about that, people.
Okay, what we did talk about, we got the comments on our draft one from Robin McClellan. Robin, unfortunately, he has pretty basic computer software. He sent me, he turned our PDF and he had his comments on there. And we could comment on his comments, but we couldn't print them out. I don't have, all we did was talk about them. We got comments from Steve Bird. He's he worked on the Henderson Wind Law as a professor at Clarkson. We got some from Jason Coltnar. He's with the county planning office. We'll go through that, all this stuff that I got from these guys. We got one from Tom Weitzel. He sent us information from Calvin Martin, and that was a copy of the Malone Law. There was no comments on our law, it was just on the Malone Law. We got one from Gary and James Snell, and we got comments on here, and Luke Martin. And I like to read Luke's. I have number 9. We got a copy of it tonight. Is this one?
Yes.
Number 6.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about this later on. I'll just do it for the heart. The paragraph says, the facility is designed to operate in compliance with applicable state, local laws and regulations, except that the board may elect not to apply in horn or any local ordinance, law, resolution, or any other action or any regulation such is unreasonably burdensome in view of existing technology. Seeing that the industry technology seems to be finding that higher and longer blades make the wind turbines much more efficient, I wonder if our wind law ought to be written in such a way that we don't need to change it every time the technology changes, or have our law be found to be too burdensome. Instead of stating it cannot be over a certain height, or it must be a certain distance from a residence, say, rather say so many times the height of the wind turbine. So many times the height of the wind turbine's total height for all setbacks, like you do with the property lines. Example would be 5 times the height of the total height of the wind turbine instead of 2,500 feet, or 500 foot tall turbine. Then if the technology wants 600 foot turbines, the setback would be 3,000 foot, etc. All right, and any other thing he mentions here is that property line setbacks for non-participating landowners ought to allow said landowner to be able to subdivide his land and place a residence on the subdivision. Often the Amish buy a large farm and divide it into two smaller farms. Such subdivisions increase our tax base and also make good use of the land. Okay, here's one other thing. He said, close to the town of Shelburne is a wind farm with some white turbines and some gray turbines. The gray turbines are much less visible than the white. We talked about this when we go through the thing here, but Luke is here. Luke, I did check out the gray turbines in the FAA, Federal Aviation Administration, they require them to be white. So, I don't know what the gray. But that's in Canada, so they don't have FAA there yet. Something else. But when we got to the setback thing, we talked about that. Since the work session, Mike Grove got a chance to look at the town of Hopkinton's draft, and Mary Jane Toomey got a chance to look at the Parishville draft, and went through them item by item, and we broke it down, and we sat with them a week ago, and Mike and Mary Jane, they put the papers back and forth, and they had some comments from Attorney Maluski, and they put some suggestions, and I think Mary Jane's going to bring those suggestions to their wind advisory board when they meet in the next week or so, 2 weeks maybe. But Mike and her did some stuff, so I wrote down what the guys do. He sent them, we got another letter from Madeline Pennington, and I think she said something about, she pretty much reiterated what Luke said about sticking with 6 times the height of the proposed WEX and using the height rather than a certain distance. 1.25 miles from the school, and she goes on about questions about noise standards. We got one from Amber Lindsay, and she suggested we stick with no less than 3,000 feet from the property line. We got something from the Environmental Design and Research. They're contracted by Avangrid, and they sent us some information about areas of visibility that they spots around town where the view is pretty nice, and they have to be addressed by the tower company. And they're asking us for input of other sites around town that we might be concerned about. Luke Daly sent us some stuff yesterday this morning and again tonight. And I might have come from Northwood, what was that?
Both, team effort.
Okay, anyhow, if you guys want, we'll go through the local, our first draft and just the stuff we talked about. Okay, first, I talked to this with, when Mike and Mary Jane that, I took a section from our Land and Development Code, and I think in section two, the very title to our draft, I got extra copy of Mike. It said scare on it. I'm good for you.
Fred, are you following the draft that was on the website? Is that what draft you're following?
Our Parishville draft.
Yeah, okay.
You want it on paper?
Pardon?
Come up one on paper?
No, no, Parishville.
We got it.
Okay.
Okay, yes, all right, thank you, go on. But anyhow, I took this from our code. Right in the very first page, section two, but whenever the requirements of this local law are at variance with the requirement of any lawfully adopted rules, regulations, orders, or local laws, the most restrictive or those imposing the highest standard shall govern. This law shall read in its entirety as follows, and then according to the section law. Yes. The next item that you came across was in, on page four, Attorney Malusky commented on the town of Hopkinton, and also in our original law, and something that the Vanguard had written, that we have a conflict by using, we call it a hunting camp, a residence, and suggested we take that out. And Hopkinton has already taken that out. So we're going to take the word Huntington out of residence.
So why would that be? Residences are now out of this law?
Not seasonal, just, there's a different definition for a hunting camp under APA regulations.
Yeah.
Why, I don't know, but...
But there are no turbines in the, inside the blue line.
Yeah, exactly.
So...
But the definition of a hunting camp. It's not a seasonal residence. It's less than a seasonal residence.
So why would you use that outside of the blue line? Why would you use the APA's definition outside the blue line? I could give you the APA...
Excuse me, ma'am. The attorney suggested we take it out because it conflicts with our zoning code.
Okay, so what I'll do...
We haven't decided yet. I'm just telling what you're going to say, okay?
Yeah, please look at that closer.
All right.
I have concerns also.
Okay, good.
But I'm just telling you why they you know, they're saying, you know, and I don't understand either.
Because we could say the opposite.
Especially now that hunting camps...
We can say the opposite.
Not all hunting camps are hunting camps anymore.
That's right.
A lot of them are more of a three season...
That's correct.
Or greater.
Absolutely.
And if you get in trouble with your wife, they could turn into a year-round.
Exactly.
Thanks for the info. Please keep looking at that.
Again, page five, we have sound pressure level. Robin McClellan questioned it. It's something about the any other day, 45 dBA can be equal to a seat for 10% of time or 6 minutes. In other words, and definitely the sound pressure level. Steve Bird, the professor in Clarkson, he said that 6 minutes is sufficient. And Attorney Malusky agreed. So, in other words, I'm just saying Robin's ruling as is. Robin's question is answered by the attorney and by the professor.
Which attorney?
Maluski. Small wind energy conversion system, and that, Hopkinton has suggested they change theirs to, conversion, which has rate capacity of 5 kilowatts. Not less than 5 kilowatts, all right? So it's gonna be between 5 kilowatts and 100 kilowatts, it's a small energy, conversion system. We had no minimum on that. So, they suggested, they're gonna look at 5 kilowatts. What do you think that's, I mean, we don't have a minimum on it. And I guess you can get this little, you can put on your solar bulb, I guess, the rest of 5 kilowatts. They'll send them going through the solar process if they're less than 5 kilowatts. Page six. There's some questions about the transfer of wind energy facility, and the attorneys, the town of Hopkinton, we have some questions about that too, so they're gonna work on some language for that transfer. And what I'd like to, when we do our third draft, put in here whatever we get from them. In other words, see, we can't make a change without having a meeting, but if we get something like this, just a couple of new sentences put in here, I can't help but put in our third draft, so it doesn't hold us up for a whole couple of weeks while we're waiting for a meeting. And I don't know what's gonna say, I don't know what we're doing yet, so. I think, oh yeah, wait a minute. I think we did discuss this a little more with Mary Jane. The way it's written, the wind energy company could not transfer their stock, more than 3% of their stock without permission from the town board. And all they're saying is that we should have that in there, but we shouldn't have it that they notify us within a certain period of time, within 30 days. That they have to notify the town within 30 days that they have transferred more than 3% of the stock. That's a legal change. Yeah, that's in the, this is what they suggest. We put in there, will occur without written acceptance by the transferee of the obligation of the transferer under this local law. Notice of such transfer shall be filed with the town official within 30 days. Okay, going all the way up to page 9. The application of wind energy facilities and conversion systems, we ask that the, in the application, they have a surveyor prepare a plot plan showing all this information. One of them was the location, approximate dimensions, and types of existing structures and uses on site, public roads, and adjoining properties. Then we had 750, and Hopkinton suggested we change that to 2,500 feet. And then on a big one, on page 10, I don't believe we didn't catch this before. We had them to draw maps with circles around each tower, three different circles, and we have perimeter in here instead of radius. We had to change that to radius. And instead of having a, you want a radius equal to 1.5 times the height of the tower, and then a radius 5 times the height of the tower, and a radius of, On page 10, right? Bottom of page 9. We had, bottom of page 9. Yeah. Okay. Yep. Okay, we had perimeter in there. H, see the H, little I after it. Yeah, we had perimeter. And instead of 1.5 times the height of the tower, we're going to go with 5 times the height of the tower. That's just like I said, two Fed radios, never done. And then on that same page, when you get down to the decommissioning plan.
What were the numbers again on the radius?
Yeah, five times the radius of the tower.
Five times the tower height.
Of the tower.
Height.
Okay, five times.
And so is it 500 foot perimeter still or radius?
Radius.
All of them are radius?
Yeah, I should not say perimeter. I guess I should have just said radius and put up the rest of it out. Robin McClellan brought up on a decommissioning plan that we allow landowner involvement. This was also something that we used to mention to the town hospital and they agreed. What we had in there, that we were going to have the wind company and the decommission remove all the topsoil, and they thought that they should allow the landowner to decide whether they want all that taken off or not. A real minor thing on
about steps in addition to nine, is that correct?
Yeah.
All at nine?
On page 10.
On page 10, essentially number six.
Section 11, item. That's a real big thing I want to talk about here. Rob had a question from the engineer. As part of the noise analysis, he wanted to know if when they do their noise analysis, if they should do it at different speeds and percentage of the average wind overall wind speed. And I couldn't answer that. But it's a piece of research. Section 11, number 18.
Okay. 11?
13.
Fred, can you go back to the decommissioning plan for a second? I thought they discussed the depth of changing that from 3 feet to 4.
Oh, that's on another section. That's on another page.
That's something.
Yeah, that was
on the ag.
Yeah, there's a decommissioning plan.
I thought that was on page 10 as well.
I got it.
We might not have, that's something I think I'm going to have to go through everything after we get it and make sure everything jives with each other because there's...
Yeah.
What was that, you had 3 to 4?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Four feet deep.
Yeah, that's in a different place.
Yeah.
I got it marked.
It does say it on number 9.
It does say it on number 9, that's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
It says you're right here, the degree is supposed to be down to 3.
Yeah. 48. Yeah, 3 feet. You ready?
Well, it should have changed that.
Yeah, well, you guys are going back so fast.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. That's all minor stuff. Same thing with that section 11, number 18. This is property owners requested in the application process. We want everybody them to give us a name and address, whatever they would. 1,000 feet, and the hospital is changing theirs to 2,500.
What page are you on, Fred?
Yeah, 13.
Page 13.
What number?
18.
Yep. And another change in the distance, we had it written down within, on 12F, page 14. We originally were going to send out a notice of public hearing to everybody within 1,500 feet. That should be 2,500 feet. transmission lines from the tower to any building or other structure shall be located underground to the maximum extent practical. And we want to add and mark, I think it should be marked above ground. And on that same page, number D, Robin had questioned if we do, if we should do further research, if there's any way to shield the lights from the ground. If the FAA required lights in the towers, okay, be shielded so they didn't stand on ground. Right now there are, he said that there's lights that they put over them so that near observatories, lights don't shine up. And people are real full starting. He thought there might be something where you could put them underneath. However, he just asked about that. He didn't give me any information. And we talked about it at that work day and said, you guys are researching. I bet you didn't.
No.
Also,
no, we're close to moving on.
Stay down here.
Oh, okay, then.
Also, there's some places have a system where the lights on the towers don't come on until aircraft approaches them. And that's in some of our statements that you have.
Kate Benson, On Demand Lighting.
Yeah, AVSWS, On Demand Lighting.
That's one of the stuff we got last night.
I don't know if you've got it.
Oh, you got that last fall.
I didn't get to the copier.
You didn't get it?
Last fall, it's in Kate Benson's law.
Oh.
On Demand Lighting, it's called.
AVWS, I think.
Okay, so I'll tell Robin if you guys did it for us.
No, it's two different things. He's talking about dark sky friendly where what they have is shielded, and we're talking about something that doesn't come on at all until it's approached by aircraft.
Where do they have that now, you said?
Kate Benson. In their law. That's what's written in. Of course, they also put setbacks of 10.5 times the tower height, which would be good.
Let's go on 13. I'm going to go to I, page 16. And this is where Wex, during the construction, all topsoil is supposed to be stocked on site. Rob McClellan suggested that we add and so did Maluski. I don't know if Mike, if Robin listened to talk a lot, but we seem to hit each other. Anyhow, he said we should add something for landowner input. And the phrasing is, he came up with that we should add, except where underlying fee owner of the land requests otherwise. In other words, the landowner can determine where he wants the topsoil put, if he wants to reuse it or. So here's the big one Maluski came up with. On M, he said the North State Department of Agriculture and Markets, most current guidelines for agricultural mitigation for wind power projects and on. He thinks we should just add most current version. If we do that, everything from then on is what he calls superfluous, and it could conflict with the most current version. And he must do something to happen to him, because he must have told them this earlier, because they took it all out. They took out all the siting goals. And it makes sense. Robert even agreed with it, because it it could be confusing, because the I guess the North State Department of Agriculture Market guidelines, they change it every couple of years, sometimes annually, and all the stuff we put out is obsolete. So that's going to take out all of page 17, all of page 18, all of page 19,
and the top half of page 20 all the way down to the end.
Just 19, up to end.
Yeah, end phase.
Everything from end down.
Now, this is something that Luke Martin suggested and Melon Pennington. Under O, construction times.
What about N? You're going to stay with the 500 feet?
What was that?
N, you're staying with the 500 feet?
That's what we didn't talk about changing that. That's something, I'd like to put an X in there and let the town board decide. You know? I mean, that's what we have in here at this point in time.
No, I don't question that.
If where they, on the beginning of M, when they say you take everything out, shall be adhered to both inside and outside of agricultural district, do we lose our environmental monitor then? Because I think that's important. It says who will be paid for him and who will have the, you know, we don't want to give Joe more work. See, because
this stuff you took out of...
The applicant project sponsor shall be responsible to provide financial funding to the township in order for the township to retain the services of an environmental monitor. I think we need that in the very beginning of M.
Yes, that is still in there. We just took out the siting goals.
Just the siting goals. Great. Excellent.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah.
I'm on page 16.
Yeah. M1. Yeah.
Yeah, from
M1 down.
So you keep the whole...
We take out M, second M, that's all this stuff under M, after
one.
That, first paragraph,
yeah,
one
from
down.
One
down.
Down.
All right. So I think it was page 20, hours of construction, that was suggested that we change, and as long as they notify the code enforcement officer.
Oh, what?
August 10th is going to hold.
Wait, you're going to keep those 7 a.m. to 7 p.m., correct?
Yeah, but we want to allow them, there are situations where they're going to have crane and stuff on site, as long as they notify the people nearby and the code enforcement officer, that's a good.
What about consent instead of just notice? They could leave a message on his phone, and it would be better if they had to get permission. We've talked about this before.
Yeah, that's a big question mark to have.
Howard says may only occur with the approval of the town.
That's what I thought. Yeah. Good.
After notice, we have notices. So we're going to put a big question mark on the word notice, right?
Yep.
Or his assistant. We need three or four people to go. There's still a question in our thing about our fence. We said that we should allow the landowner.
I'm going to change that.
Yeah. Okay, this is what we had written. NPQRS. No WEC shall make abnormal noises caused by mechanical malfunction or maintenance deficiencies within the required 2,500 feet distance from them. This is where we have residents, and the reason we have residents here, I'll explain later. Above the level allowed in section, and I couldn't find the section that we're working at. I have to fill in that.
The WEX must be taken offline within 8 hours of notification by the town hall code board.
Are you at 23?
Where are you? Town supervisor or other person designated by the town board. This is something we're adding.
What? Oh, you got it. Where?
Adding.
We're adding a, we're adding an S to section 13.
Yeah.
Oh, section 13. Oh, S.
Currently ends in Q.
Yeah.
Yep.
20, page 20. R, where?
R.
Where's the R?
R.
What R? Not on page 20.
It's R?
Yeah.
Up here?
I guess it's what I'm here, I should have talked about before I started. Anyhow. Required safety measures, you're going to go about the fence. This is suggested, a 6-foot-high fence with locking portal shall be required to enclose each tower or group of towers unless the landowner requests no such fencing to allow convenient access to those areas for farming. The color and type of fencing for each WEX installation shall be determined on the basis of individual application as safety needs dictate. That is going back to the original.
Yep. And then Malusky.
He had some comments on that.
Yeah, he had comments on the fence and.
Yeah.
And farming and they were unnecessary.
Yeah, he didn't think that they.
So I think we were, and I didn't do my homework here and rewrite it, but we were talking about changing that instead of shall be required. But if a landowner requests it, a fence will be put in. And that's just because of the lawyer.
Can we go up to noise standards, 16? On page 22. Where we have 16A, page 22. It was suggested we take out church and change that to place of worship. Right, and then we get down, if the ambient noise level measured or near such structure, the standard shall be equal to the ambient noise level.
Where are we on 22?
This is where we had, go down the wall. We wanted 45 dBA between hours 7, 8, and.
Bottom of page 21.
Chris, on a different version.
Yeah, I got.
Oh, okay.
Good. So what page you guys on?
21, bottom of 21. 16A.
Yeah. Oh, it starts on 21, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
We didn't, we changed the first sentence.
Yeah.
Now you got to flip it over.
No.
Well, I have to put my own.
Yeah.
For some reason, it's printed.
Oh, yeah.
Have you not discussed?
So we took the church out, put in a place of worship, and the time we put in our first draft was 45 dBA between hours 7 and 7 p.m. Mary Jane suggested we take up the next one. So it's going to be 35 dBA between hours 7 a.m. and 7 p.m. And 35 dBA between the hours of 7 p.m. and 7 a.m. the next day. The next day. We'll just take the 40 out.
Fred, you might have a problem with that. There are some groups, like the Amish and our group, we meet at home.
Yeah, that's the thing.
So that's going to change, change, change.
Your place of worship, right? That's why we changed it from church to place of worship.
Okay.
Okay? That's the reason why we took the word church out.
Who's going to say where that is when?
Where when?
That's not always at the same place.
Yeah, I know. That's going to be confusing, isn't it? That was,
Well, in the way this is written here, and I don't know if it'll It says existing at the time of application, not on site.
So that means all of your houses that you can are existing at the time of application. Because of the worship.
Yeah, that makes problems, but.
Yeah.
So if we left the word church in there, it's not a problem, but if we change the place of worship.
No.
No, no.
Place of worship.
Worship is.
But Fred, can I just mention one thing? On the, you're measuring, you're saying from the outside of the place of worship or the dwelling or whatever. And I just want to interject this here. It has been proven, someone from Hopkinton went over to Kevin Sigourney's home and witnessed firsthand that it was actually louder inside his home than outside. Because your home sometimes it just reverberates inside.
That's the vibration could have been.
Some people could be driven crazy by that, and yet they're saying, nope, it's within the perimeters, you know? This isn't protecting us. So you might want to say and inside the dwelling as well as outside the dwelling, is all I'm saying.
Well, we get it. I'm gonna read the whole paragraph. Control of sound pressure level generated by a west and sources unrelated to the turbines shall not exceed those leg A weighted decibels listed below, measured at 10-minute intervals at the nearest property line, school, hospital, place of worship, or public building existing at the time of application not on site. Independent certification shall be required before and after construction, demonstrating compliance with this requirement. If the ambient noise level measured at the nearest structure, the standard shall be equal to the ambient noise level. Okay? And then go length, times listed below are 45 dB between hours of 7 a.m. and 7 p.m., 35 dBm between the hours of 7 p.m. to 7 a.m. the next day.
Fred, is that something you're going to discuss now, or?
Well, we're talking about right now.
I thought we were going to change it to 35.
Will the board consider 35 24 hours a day?
I really think you might want to look at the presentation that I sent you.
Yeah, that's what.
Right, I think this needs a little more research than just discussion.
But I think that
I gave you
that's
two
appropriate
today.
That you change that now so that it's in there.
It's 45 dBA between 7 a.m. and 7 p.m. came from Pete Vincent, right?
Yeah.
And then we took out the other ones. So.
Something we could. I mean, I started to look at that, but I've got a 10-year-old computer. And
Yeah, it's
if a truck goes by sometimes, I lose everything. So.
It's very complex. I still get the Hammond law, which Kate Vincent would be going above and beyond, because they did it afterwards, which means there'd be a lot more research than that. But that law, that part, takes up over 5 pages, not just a few paragraphs. So I think a lot more research is needed before you decide which should go there as a in your work session.
Yeah, there's a question about in the same page started down, Robin asked if there's any way we can include remote noise monitoring. In other words, some kind of monitoring device you can access through a web system, so you can check it remotely from an office somewhere. Like Avangrid can check it from their office to see if somebody complains, they can put a monitor out there, and instead of leaving it there and go check it every couple of days, they can check it.
No offense, but if I have problems, I'll be getting my own independent acoustical expert. I'm not going to depend on Avangrid.
Okay.
There was a 2-hour window for complaints with Iberdrola, and
2-hour window?
2-hour window. They had 2 hours to respond to a complaint. This is in the Clarksburg, Massachusetts, Hoosick Wind. 9 hours later, somebody showed up. That's an Iberdrola project. That's a lot of sleep loss.
They're 4 hours different time zone, too.
in the Hammond law, there's specifications of how frequent and how often the measurements need to be taken. It's not just a one-time deal, and has specifications of how far off the ground the microphone it needs to be. So I think there's a lot more needs to be in that.
FPNR technical.
Right, that's why I suggest an expert, because we need an expert to fully stack up.
Particularly, Fred, since these are the highest towers they've built, the noise is going to be greater. So I think that's why you put it in and then maybe do some more research. But I would urge you to put that 35 in 24 hours a day.
Yeah, you're seeing the ones over in Chattagay, the high ones. Before, they didn't really have any problems with a lot of complaints on noise. Now they're having a lot of complaints.
This is going to be the two big points.
We need a moratorium to do more study.
When we have a public hearing between all the parties involved. On the same page, you get down to, I'm not quite sure what the same page you did, number D.
Yeah, that's on page two.
Yep. Egress shall be set back. We got comments from the county and planning office on this. And, also from an attorney for the town of Hopkinton, and town of Hopkinton may be making these changes. I'm not sure if I have, I don't know, but they wanted to change the setbacks pretty much as per Luke Martin's suggestion and the Badlands. They got this, they would like us to change ours to be, each wax shall be set back from site boundaries measured from the center of the wax a minimum distance of 5 times the total height of the proposed wax from the nearest non-participating property line, 5 times the total height of the wax from the nearest public road, 5 times the total height of the proposed wax from the nearest edge of the wind overlay zone, 5 times the total height of the wax from the nearest residence, assessing at the time of the application, measured from next to the such residence, 5 times the total height of the wax from any non-participating building, farm, or commercial structure, or any above-ground utilities. This setback shall not apply to minor non-habitable structures such as fences, gates, flagpoles, signs, billboards, or other light structures, or any building or structure associated with the wind energy facility itself. 1.5 times the total height of the wax from any state or federally identified wetlands or body of water. This distance may be adjusted to be greater at the discretion of the town planning board based on topography, land cover, land uses, and other factors that influence the flight patterns of resident birds, bats, or other species. 5 times the total height of the proposed wax from the Adirondack Park industry boundary. Yeah, that's it.
Question, did you say participating residents is also?
Okay. You had to pay close attention to that, and I went away. Non-participating property line.
Right.
And then when we say residents, that's all residents, including the participating.
Okay.
So if you're a landowner, instead of you get a servant on your property, they suggested we keep it 5 times the height from that residence also, because the next landowner, if you sell out, the next resident of that house would be too close. And the county planning officer said the reason for that is you have to protect people from themselves.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
it's a little late almost.
The setback now for all that at 2,500 feet?
2,500 feet.
Is what you have now?
No.
Okay. Yeah. Setback.
And we have now, this is a draft, okay?
Okay.
We're talking about changing.
Okay.
It's 2,000 feet now from the property.
Okay. So my concern is that is whatever you have now, leave it at a minimum or go 5 times. Well, I thought it was at 2,500 feet, so you're saying 2,000 feet. So you might be doing us a great disservice if you go 5 times. I think you should have a minimum. of 2,500 feet, and then anything greater, five times the height. Because if they get a wind area that's on a ridge or whatever, they can build these short towers, 300 feet, they're not all the same as these wind farms. They can build shorter towers, now we're at 1,500 feet. So you should have a minimum, and then rather than, like Luke and Madeline have said, every time the technology changes and follow all this, hit a minimum, and then go with whatever times the height you want for everything after that.
At the minimum.
Okay.
Fred, I think you said five times the total height? That's what you got from Jason and the lawyer?
No, that's what we got from Luke Martin and the town of Hoppington suggested. I don't know about...
Okay, because I had six times the total height.
And that's the question I have.
Some had six, some had seven.
I have seven.
Will this board consider six instead of the five all the way through?
I would put X in there.
Well, but they want...
But they're not doing the research.
No, they don't want that, Fred. They want you to recommend.
We'll defend you.
Well, there's a reason I put...
I could really change the number, but it's hard to change a paragraph.
Right, I understand.
That's what I'm trying to do.
We can always tweak it. I mean, that's, you know, if you get it into the next draft, we can always tweak that number, like you're saying. Right now it's five.
Okay.
If you want...
As long as you're open to discussion. That's what I want to hear.
The day we hand this to the town board, then you can go after them and...
We will.
We're open to discussion.
No, but we are. If you get it into the draft, then it's easier for us to go back. This is the change we made. Now let's talk about it and then take your information.
I mean, I had the wrong assumption that you were staying with the five.
No, once again...
That's what we're plugging in right now.
Once again, this is a draft, and we're gonna have probably draft after draft until it's finalized.
The hardest part we have is land determined out.
Understand that.
You know, between property line and residence. You gotta play property line not participating, residence, all residences, okay? It's easy to change the number, but it's hard to change the paragraph. All right, what else can you talk about, Fred?
If it was 2,500 feet from a property line too, Fred, that would allow for expansion of homes. Whereas you're saying 2,000 feet from a property line...
No, that's existing.
Existing is 2,000.
Their proposal is 25.
Our proposal is 25.
Okay.
This is, we're still working draft one now.
Yeah.
All right.
So we've got five times for most of these things plus a minimum. You've got a minimum. Do you have a minimum on these?
This is just suggested to us.
On these suggested.
That was just suggested, Diane. We have it written down now, so that will...
Good. But is the minimum for every single one of these, one, two, three, four, five, six?
Yeah, yep. Every five times instead of...
And 2,500 foot.
And one and a half times for the wetland. Okay. Now, on abatement decommissioning, section 20, CII, page 25. Foundations and buried, this is under decommission. Foundations and buried project components other than buried collection lines must be removed to a depth of 48 inches instead of 36. Change that to 48.
Twenty-six CII.
Under 20, section C, and 3. Roman numeral 3.
2.
Oh, 2.
2. 2. It's on the foundations and the buried project component. And the reasoning for this is farming.
Yes.
You know, sometimes if they're going deep, you know, and the reason we didn't say collection line because of the plow, it's a collection, you know, a wire. It's going to not harm the plow and rip it in half, but if it's a piece of concrete that's under there, you know.
But Mike, some guys that work on these things told us that what they do for those collection lines, the transmission lines that they put underground, is they dig a trench, then they put bags of ready mix in there and let them turn into cement, which are like.
You guys do that?
They're like.
Not aware of that.
Not aware of that?
First I've heard it.
Yeah.
Not aware.
Yeah, I know that my brother-in-law's have done some work on them and did the wiring because they're electricians.
And they don't do that?
And they haven't done that either, because I did ask them about that.
It was Chris Shay, I think, that told us.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll ask again, though.
Okay, thanks.
Because we can change that if we have to also.
Someone who that is their area of expertise.
Yeah.
Now, for that foundation that they have to be removed to a depth of 36 inches, is that 36 inches below the ground? Because sometimes they are like this, and the pole goes up. So it's 36 inches from the top, that's different than 36 inches from the ground.
Well, we could put in from grade.
At the grade.
Yeah.
Yep. And the next case, number three, the brick collection line, well, first number two says, other than brick collection line, then three allows brick collection lines to be at 36 inches. Why is that? Because we, the frost line, if you want to do a good building, you want to go down below 36 inches.
Oh, yeah.
And for field tiles, drain tiles, things like that, sometimes we need to go greater than 36 inches. So we have anything that we need to go through, and it's at, their cable is at 36 inches. That's too far up for us.
36 inches too far up.
For a barricade.
Yeah, we changed that, that's why we changed the 48.
But he's talking about the cable.
He's talking about the cable.
The buried lines.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
We took the break.
I think you took it all 48.
We thought, you know, we discussed that, and I had it penciled in on mine at one time, the 48, but, yeah.
Yeah, I.
Yeah. Yeah, 48 works for me.
Okay. No,
just to be consistent.
How could then, in fact, have been working in a decommissioned bother fund, and we're waiting for some word on that from our attorney about just the terminology on it. I think Lori said something tonight about us.
Escrow.
Escrow.
Get the money up front. That's the only thing you can do is get it up front.
Yeah.
Well, just look at how many names they have for Iberdrola. You have several different LLCs, so that should tell you that possibly there could be different LLCs.
This is something that our terminology is really, really close, but those numbers could change. And
sometimes, I think you built in like it should be reevaluated every so many years, right? Because as costs go up, you need to maybe get some more money added to that fund.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Financial shifting from there on escrow. Yeah, that's something not set in stone yet, but it's going to, basically our terminology is saying that the numbers could change. And there was a question about what happens if when they go bankrupt. And I think that whole financial assurance thing is the terminology is good, it's got to be tweaked, and that's the term itself. On page 27, 22, second 22 permit, revocation. Mr. Maluski suggested we take the word periodic noise testing by a qualified independent third-party physical measurement consultant. He suggests we change that to certified independent third-party acoustical measurement consultant.
Is it
42A.
42A.
On page 27.
And it's got something to do with licensing. You know, like anybody can call himself qualified. But when you're certified, you have a code of practice you got to follow, and if you screw up, you can lose your certification, your license. So he was pretty strong about that.
Do you have an actual picks that certified person?
Who is what?
Who picks that? Is it up to the wind company to choose that certified person, or is it up to the town? Because that could get you two different results.
Well, it's a fund that's set up. And the fund is set up and given to the town. So I'm assuming that the town board has the way we get the town board.
If it's independent, yeah.
Okay, now we're down to development standards for the small WECs. 31 development standards, D. They suggest we change this. Small WECs may be used primarily to generate unsafe power or to reduce the unsafe consumption of purchased electricity. Maximum turbine output is limited to 100 kilowatts. A small WEX with rated capacity less than 5 kilowatts and not connected to power grid is exempt from small WEX permit requirements. They're going to have to be smaller and smaller than 5 kilowatts.
Where are you? 31, 30? Page
33, section 31, development standards of the small WEX.
All right, thank you.
And it was basically redoing B.
Thank you. Okay. And what was it again?
Craig, you want to read that again?
Small WEX may be used primarily to generate unsafe power or to reduce the unsafe consumption of purchased electricity. That's purchased, right? Maximum turbine output is limited to 100 kilowatts. A small WEX with rated capacity less than 5 kilowatts and not connected to the power grid is exempt from small WEX permit requirements. The fees on page.
Section 33 fees, the bottom, page 35.
Yep. Hopkinton is suggesting that they change your fee of $500 a megawatt and $350 for a wind turbine power.
$300 to $350.
Wind measurement tower.
Okay.
And special permit for a WEX, $500 per megawatt. We had the town board when we said it. I missed telling what happened.
Well, and Rodney.
Okay.
Looked at that.
Robin has some questions that I can answer. So there's no questions. Just nothing. Oh. I mean, I'm just telling you.
Okay.
I got a rule now. I wrote some stuff in here.
Yep.
Oh, and then I didn't know if I should attach an appendix to this and put our thing over in that. Yeah. Oh yeah, here's the big one though. This has been a real pain working with this layout. And what we wanted to do, what I wanted to do, I wanted to change the whole format, outline, to be the same as our land use development code. And how that's set up, it goes to, we have like section 2,
Anybody want to see the landlord's code to see how it's numbered?
I've got one.
It's just a lot easier to work with, and at the top of each page, it shows you what section you're in, and you don't have to worry about page number, just read a number, you can hear that number. Sometimes you print it out on one printer, and you print the same exact thing out in MS Word on one printer, and the pages are all off by then.
What they're doing yesterday.
Yeah, like you've been doing. And I got a copy of that here, Jeff Terry. Yeah, it looks like this. In other words, when we get to Article 2, creation of window overlay zone on our current draft, it's Article 2, Section 10. Our new one's going to be Section 2.01. And then next one, 11, it'll be Section 2.02. Instead of 12, it'll be 2.03. And it's numeric. And then when you go to a subsection, it just follows the numeric sequence. It's a lot easier to look at them in this section, you get a little crazy when you find it. But there again, we talked about, I wanted to do that, but I couldn't do it without us agreeing to it. All right, now we've got a whole bunch more stuff to see today, and we haven't had a chance to look at it, so. There's some constructive stuff here. Somebody gave us this one, it's got a lot of blue in it. I think it's from Lori.
It's mostly the definition section again, Fred, because so I think...
The red is...
Don't worry about the colors, just...
Okay,
because that was all before you've done a new draft.
Okay, what's new then?
They want more definition.
Okay.
Than what you have in your current...
Okay.
It basically goes from page 1 to page 7, I think. No, 7. It changes it from, yeah. What I think she sent you was up till your page. Ours goes up to page 11. And I think it for you it started page 7. It ends up at your page 7 because we added a lot of definitions.
You know what we did with our code? Because when we first started our code, it was suggested all these definitions. And what we did, we got a standard code book that's accepted by planning boards and zoning boards all over the country. And we just cited that. And we got 3 copies of it. We gave one to the lawyer, and we got 2 on file here at the town hall. And it saved us about 11 pages from that code.
So you do you refer to that book?
Yeah.
Yeah. Your...
But that was for
your regular
zoning law. Hundreds of towns.
Oh, that's in the land use and development code.
Yeah. Right.
Okay. But this is what you originally got from NYSERDA or the model land law, okay? Mm-hmm. What you got in your draft
is back in 2011. Current law. Okay, so that's stuff we gotta look at. I talked to you about changing limits. That's all I have on my discussion of the limit. You guys got anything? I got stuff from going into the gap.
I do have one little comment that I noticed in our wind measurement towers where we call for a decommissioning plan, you know, including security bond or cash or removal, but we don't specify anything in that. So it's on page 28. Probably on 27 for you, but who knows?
Well, under the draft or the other
It's a draft in our existing law, because I don't think we... 28. Yeah, the standards for, or it's a application for wind measurement towers, number five.
Application 29.
Yeah, yeah, it could be on the top of page 29 or the bottom of 28. You know, we don't, all we say is decommissioning plan, and we don't flesh it out anyhow. And I just looked at our, just came up with this, specified in section 20, sub C, D, and E, which, I should write down page numbers here, I'm flipping back.
Fred, it's on four, under your chair. Under your pen. Fred, while you're looking there, I have kind of a generic question. Is there any restriction, this is on siting of towers, once a company meets the setback requirement, anything that restricts them from saturating a site with three or four towers at their will? There's nothing in here that prevents that, is there?
There was something about they had to get a special use permit, but they didn't have to go through the application.
I thought the towers themselves had to be 1.5 times height between towers. Isn't that right?
Where is that?
I don't know where it is, I thought I read it.
Yeah.
Long time ago.
Somehow that sticks in my mind also. But just from a...
1.5 towers, that's only 750 feet apart. They decided to go around a property, ding, every 750 feet.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's the way it was.
But I have a question for you guys. Isn't there, you usually don't site towers that close because the wind deflection, the wind turbulence from one affects another?
Absolutely.
As far as their efficiency and...
It would never be done that way. It's all about optimizing for energy capture. It's all about being within the specs of the turbine itself. So, you know, these are things that a developer would not do.
Well...
And a turbine vendor would not allow.
But we will check on it, you know, we'll look through our law.
But I just questioned...
We'll look through that too, and see if you can find it, let us know where you...
My question to you guys is, you're telling me all 40 of these tentative sightings are based on wind? You just use the term of wind?
Efficiency.
Every design of a wind plant is based on the wind resource at the wind plant. So, you know, what applies here may not apply at another site and vice versa. So everything is designed to the wind resource itself.
Well,
so you might have spacing here that would apply, but it may not apply to some other site, and vice versa.
There's no coincidence that six towers are sited on one person's property, ding, 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 and then they're scattered all over, every place else.
I'm not aware of six towers being on any one property.
I'm saying on the same property, but they're, on 72, you placed six towers very close together in a row, and just...
They're placed very close, they're placed appropriately for the optimizing of energy capture, they're placed appropriately as far as setbacks in the current local law, and they're placed appropriately for health and safety.
The current local law, or the law that you're requesting to expand?
Yeah, that's a good point.
It's based on the current local law with the change, with our requested change, and proposed change to the noise limit, not to the property boundaries, but to the exterior of the residence.
So if you're saying they go to the specs of that wind, this generator, then you must know the model number that you expect to put here.
We look at various scenarios.
Thank you. I didn't put you on the spot or anything, but Gary will, I'll keep looking.
Okay, I'll check for those two.
Okay, if you guys think that, those changes are okay, then at least type up, at least start typing section, draft two, and that new format, you know, the general is one, and get them to change. Do you have to put a motion in there?
I'll make a motion that we, start draft two.
All right, now we're down to move business. Lynn, you don't propose, the town kind of wants to do that simultaneously. So, but they do, and there's a couple things in there, like, we got all this stuff about color copying sites, which we copied it from another town. And they told us it's important, but it was important to their town, because they had a color copying site, and people didn't want it in the backyard, so. So we incorporated, we never, anyhow, little things like that, but we can take a lot of this stuff, like the, once if we came up with a DDA level, we could have that for all of us.
Yeah. And height restriction for everything.
So, we took away and took our new section, and that's another thing, we changed the format, it's very easy to move one from one to the other. Okay, so, the next thing, we have an application from Seaway Timber. They have a land up, a lot up on, Pickenville Road, on, Hawk Ledge, if you want to subdivide. It's gonna be seven lots, so they have to comply with our things, we're going to call it subdivisions. They gave us the application, they gave us the money for the application. It's gonna be real basic, because it's outside the park, and they're all more than 5 acres, so we don't have to worry about the septic and the engineering plan, we don't have to involve the Department of Health. But we do have to have a public hearing. So, I thought before our next planning board meeting, we could have a public hearing on it. Right?
How many acres are you talking about?
I forget, I had a map and I, lost it. I think it was, yeah, it's since been surveyed by a major survey, he needs work for us. But I will find it.
Maybe 300 acres divided by 7, so it might be 40, 50 acres.
Yeah, there's some, one lot was 75, small lot was 11. If they set it up because of the road branch off and they want to use them, and it goes up to the other parcel. East boundary is the town line. No, south boundary is town line, right? The east line is park line. Park boundary.
They're trying to subdivide into easily sellable parcels.
Yeah, they've been on the market for a while, but has one big parcel.
Yeah.
This next to the other one, correct?
Yep. So there's access to all the lots through the Hawk Ledge Road and the, anyhow, we just have, if it was involved with.
Is that coming off Pickenville Road or off the Chapel Hill Road?
There is one lot, one small lot that's accessible, Chapel Hill Road, one lot.
By whose house?
Luford.
Luford.
Oh.
Well, up that way.
No rest of the wicked.
And we have another applicant for a lady on a White Hill Road would like to have a small business, a rural business, renting out boats, or car, top boats, or whatever. They're actually new,
Rather short. You got both permits?
Yeah.
Electric motors and a battery.
They're both exist.
Actually, they came on red.
Well, that's what I want to know.
On the very top? Hawk ledge? The Hawk, what that's called? Hawks, or the field, right? Not that, dumb. You know, Concord was here.
Yep, Concord.
Yeah, that's it.
What's the name?
Sequence. But that isn't a park. And the APA requires them to fill out a form. And I'm going to send it forth. And it's a jurisdictional request one. In other words, they send a form and the APA looks at it and says, yeah, you got to go through the APA. No, it's not that big a deal. We, as a planning board, we do have a section in our law that allows us to waive any requirements if it's a small business. Like, right now, the county, if you get a special use permit, you have to go through the county planning office. And now the county planning office requires a fee. So you have to apply, send them, I think it's $110, $120. We did, for you to have a look at the special use permit. Yeah, Ishiko Taylor wanted to put a sign up for our house. That's going to be a real small little business. We felt that it was, you know, it's a small, it was crazy to do to spend $100 plus and then have a public hearing on it and then spend $120 to county planning board and then through the county planning board, not their office, board. They actually put it under and they had them and discussed it. Yeah, and we felt it was not a big deal to wait 3 weeks to record it. She had many problems, had been some road conflict there with traffic. In this case, I don't know, 5 volts, that's more available. We could waive it, but we got to wait. She's got to deal with the APA. At the next meeting, I would really like to see what Hopkinton does with their suggested changes that we want to come there and see what the county planning office says about Hopkinton. The changes we talk about are going to be real close to what Hopkinton does. And that would save us a lot of time making our changes to what the planning board does. We could start draft two, but wait and see. And as far as the Seaway Timber subdivision, they can sell up to 4 lots before they have to do anything. So there's no time commitment there either. So when do you think you can meet it?
How long may I take for Hopkinton to progress to that point?
It's probably the month of April. What do you think?
Do we want to start setting up?
I know they're trying to set a meeting, but they haven't set a date yet.
And they won't, you won't say anything to the planning office?
I did forward
the
draft to the planning board.
Oh, so if I got in touch with them, I can get their comments when they look at it.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's great. Because
mm-hmm.
that's all, I don't care about
did
what
Mary Jane send you a copy?
Yeah, she did, but I didn't look
that's
at it.
That's exactly what I sent to the planning
okay.
board.
Yeah, I guess I should look at that.
So that's in their hands.
So I'll get hold of them and see when they think they get back to us. We'll, so I'll get their comments. If you guys don't mind, we can put them in our draft two and send out draft two for your input. Then we got to go through all your stuff too that you sent us.
While we're talking about that, yesterday they had that meeting that some of you attended at the county. One thing I found interesting, some of the county legislature doesn't seem to understand anything about what's going on.
I saw you talking to Kevin, you talked to him about it?
Yes. Yeah, and I want to get your permission to send them, well, our existing law plus our draft, so to at least let them know something about it, because they didn't have a clue on. Yeah, most of them, Rick does, and a few of them had some good questions, but a lot of them, you know, were.
They do have a subcommittee.
Yeah.
That's reviewing it.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. But, yeah, I'd like to get them, you know, in line. What do you think?
Yeah, no, I.
Okay.
They've gotten a lot of materials.
Yeah.
We've been giving them.
But the thing is, when you get a stack of materials, you don't tend to.
To look at everything and, yeah.
It looks like a lot of meetings.
Yep.
So you put it off and you put it on.
But a lot of them are short articles, they really are.
Yeah.
There's a lot of space and pretty pictures in there.
I do like pictures.
That's why if you bring in an expert, they can give you pictures to help explain it instead of having it in.
Thank you. Perfect. That's what I want.
I'm a visual.
Right.
Maybe we can present it like books on tape for you.
Yeah, yeah.
There was two other things that town Hopkins didn't do, and they haven't decided yet. One of them, they had something about insurance, having the wind company name them as an insured. Loggers have to do it all the time. They're loggers, they probably have to mention the insurance. I do it for a job at Alcoa, I have to name them as an insured, GM, or St. Lawrence. I always have to, you know, add government insured, which is food teams, a bunch of, they had that. We don't have it in our law. And I'm sure anybody that has signed a lease with the wind company has probably already had it, you know, at their lawyers probably required it too. They're thinking about putting it into their law. And there's been a lot of controversy over their real property. What's it called? Real property guarantee.
Yeah.
The property value.
Property value.
Yeah. Arnold Colton, they're going to head it, real property, they're going to care for it. A couple of crazy things going to care for it. So we left it out, but I don't know if they're going to, what they're going to do there yet.
And I've been kind of reconsidering too, the more I've done, the more.
When?
Research.
So that's something I've been looking about.
Yeah.
Fred, could I ask a question, just a clarification? You're sending this to the county planning board, correct?
Not yet.
No, when you.
We sent the last.
No, just a process or a procedure. You will send it.
Oh, yeah.
And then they send it back with suggestions. They have no legal authority over that, correct?
Right. But if we don't make the changes they suggest, then for the town board to pass it, they have to do it by a super majority.
Okay, that's what I want to clear.
Unless.
So the town board has a final say?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
So why aren't you putting in the further setback now then, before you send it to them to get their feedback on it? I don't understand. You're making these other changes.
Well,
why aren't you making a change on the setbacks? I'm just asking.
I'd like to put an X in there and let them fill in the blank.
Well,
you want
one thing is the town's lawyer told us that we're already, you know.
Yeah, professor from Colton told us.
But there's.
The
problem is that we keep having the same horror stories time after time. Unfortunately, they're not catching up to what the reality is. So how many more people have to suffer before the light bulb goes off somewhere where what they say seems to matter more than what we're saying? I mean, Shattagay, there's all kinds of complaints. Tug Hill, there's complaints. There's complaints all over. It's not a bunch of hysterical people. I mean, people don't abandon their home for no reason. So for them to just say, well, this is overly restricted, you know, if you're living in it, you would feel differently.
I could comment on that, but I don't want to do it in the meeting.
Okay.
I don't want to be official. So why don't we adjourn and then I can talk to her.
So it has to wait. We gotta do every time for, Joe asked the question before we got.
Yeah, is it even feasible for bid like regular meetings that they can plan on?
Can we do a regular meeting?
Sure, we can.
I mean, how often?
I've been in 2 years since we've had to because we haven't had much going on. So as a result, we have been meeting as needed. Wednesday's bad for Mike. Monday, you're off 2 Mondays a month.
Yeah.
I'm off 1 Monday.
Later in the month, I'm good on any day of the week.
And you're it's the first week of the month.
That I'm basically first and second week of the month.
Yeah. And they have court, the second and fourth Tuesdays.
First and third.
Sometimes they have morning, sometimes they have evening.
What's their music calendar open, Sherry? Like later in the month, what is it?
Thursdays is all plugged up here.
Thursdays are known.
Yep.
You can do Tuesday. Nope. Yeah. You can do the 11th on Tuesday.
What's that, the second Tuesday?
Yeah.
I'm good on that.
Friday nights are pretty good, except for the 28th. You have it for the 28th?
Yep.
Okay. They have it for the 28th.
Okay.
Friday nights are pretty clear. Wednesdays?
I can't do the first Wednesday of the month. That's, I might.
This is booked the first Wednesday of the month.
Okay, so I'm good on that one.
Second Tuesday, they're okay.
Yeah.
Why don't we do second Tuesday of every month? I have office hours, but I'll change it.
Yeah, you can come office hours.
Quick job.
Yeah.
Six to eight.
Skipping them right now.
Second Tuesday of the month.
But I'm here, I mean.
Does that work for the people?
Yep.
Second Tuesday of every month. Yeah.
Is that town, when does town board?
No, that's the last.
When's county?
That's Monday.
Okay, we're good.
Second Tuesday of the month.
Six or 6:30?
Do we want second Tuesday of April?
I think we should go to the third Monday.
Yeah.
Start, what are you saying?
I don't remember having time.
Yes, we might. Yeah, beginning in May.
Yeah, we can't start that board.
Beginning in May?
Yeah.
No, I can't.
Yeah.
I'd like to draft two to be real close to, real close to one. We got a lot to look at.
So second Tuesday of May?
Will be the first one.
Will be the first one?
First one in May.
Is it gonna be at?
It has a 9:00, 6:00?
It could be the 9:30.
So we like the 6:30, it doesn't matter.
What time is everybody?
But you're gonna have a meeting before then.
Whatever time you set, Lou's gonna be late. What time?
Well, 6:30, because we're all in for 6:30 today.
Yeah.
For May?
6:30.
Okay.
That was what, May 9th?
Yep. Then I can work a half hour.
But aren't you gonna have a meeting?
Aren't you gonna have a meeting before that?
Before then?
Well, if we get enough stuff, but right now, we don't think in 2 weeks we're gonna have enough.
2 weeks, that's a month and 2 weeks.
I know that, but in 2 weeks.
Yeah, I'd like to get the info from Hopkinton, because they just, I'd like to get a little close to something done.
Okay. That's 6:00 or 6:30?
6:30.
6:30.
6:30? Sure, he's here.
I got 6:30.
Yeah.
6:30.
I'll make that motion.
Okay, thank you.
All second.
All in favor?
Aye. I never see.
second Tuesday following.
And every second Tuesday following, yeah. Yep.
Thank you all very much.
Someone make your own?
No.